Thank you. At this point, I would ask all to join us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We have before us the minutes of two of our prior council meetings, meeting number 7 held October 16th and a special meeting number 8 held October 29th. What is your desire?
Mr. Chairman, I move they be accepted as printed.
Second, Madam.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion passes. Thank you very much. At this point, I would invite any citizens in the audience to come forward for discussion of items that are not on our printed agenda this evening. Is there anyone who desires to speak to a particular issue this evening? Seeing none, I will close this portion of the agenda. At this time, there are some reports and correspondence that I will begin with. And the first is that I had reported last month's meeting some unfortunate, inaccurate numbers with respect to the Cumberland County proposed budget. It wasn't that I had wrong numbers, it was that I was given wrong numbers as a consequence of the projected tax distribution schedule being based on the wrong base, which unfortunately understated the amount of the tax to the respective municipalities. This, unfortunately, the first budget that we received did not take into account the $200,000 designated surplus. And as a consequence, as the proposed Cumberland County budget stands right now, the percent tax change from last year is not 5.08%, but it is instead 7.68%. This gives Cape Elizabeth a 6.72 increase and not the 4.14% increase that I had stated last month. Although this is a difference of only 2.6%, if you look at it another way, it really is deceiving the public by 51.2%, as I figure it, in that the higher tax increase is that much more than was publicly stated in the first printout of this particular budget. And I have indicated my displeasure to the appropriate individuals at the county level so that this type of thing does not happen again. And I will continue to be working on that budget advisory group so that we can pare down those particular numbers even further. Secondly, I have before me a memo from our code enforcement officer, Mr. McVain, asking me at the council meeting tonight to inform the public that the town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting all property owners who receive damage to buildings, seawalls, etc., as a result of the October 1991 storm, to please forward repair or replacement cost estimates to the building inspector. Once he has received this particular information, he will provide it via the town to the Federal Emergency Management Agency. A second piece of correspondence I received was a letter from Peter Rand, the president of the Land Trust, indicating his displeasure at our vote essentially last meeting. And I'm in the process with the town manager in penning a response to his letter. A third piece of correspondence involves a little bit of publicity that we had over the last month in behalf of Mr. Ralph Gould. As you know from the Portland Press Herald, Mr. Gould was very generous in that he had plans and specifications prepared that would allow the town to replace the Spurwink Church should any kind of calamitous event take place. We're very deeply appreciative of this endeavor, and as you have probably read in the Portland Press Herald, that was again publicized. Another piece of correspondence that came in over the month was from one of our citizens, Mr. Sam Townsend, and he had two suggestions for us to consider, and we will as a council. The first involved the circumstances of the one-way road between the schools, the elementary slash middle school complex and the high school. As any of you know who were present at some of the more recent events at the high school, the one-act plays or the soccer final championship games, getting out of the high school egress road is really is quite time-consuming as a consequence of the one-way up through Jordan Way and the middle school area. So I am told by Rosemary Reed, one of the members of the school board, that this issue is being addressed within the school board, and we will try to give input as necessary to try to figure out if there are options to the current circumstances. Mr. Townsend suggests that perhaps it could be two-way at some point in the afternoons. And his second point was involved our continuing controversy with respect to the future possibility of signal lights in the town of Cape Elizabeth. And what he suggests is that at some point, when and if signal lights are constructed and put up, could there be a blinking yellow as needed during peak summer months or particular times during the week or day that might save inconvenience to fellow citizens? And we will again be looking at that particular issue when that when the signal lights return again to our agenda. And then lastly, we received a very nice letter from Kay Leslie, the co-chair of the Archangel Committee, thanking the town of Cape Elizabeth for Cape Elizabeth pins that were offered to our Russian friends at the Archangel exchange at the Sprague Hall that I was privileged to attend and speak at. So it was a busy month for correspondence from my desk. Other reports and correspondence. Councilor McLaughlin, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm wondering if Mr. McGovern can give us an update of the status of the building at 1231 Shore Road.
No, I cannot.
Okay.
I just don't know what the status of it is.
I meant to call you during the day.
No.
Just, I think the public should know what the council action was last meeting.
Would you like to tell the public, Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes, that's why I asked them.
You have the issue in front of you. Then I will defer this to the town manager, as the town manager is always on top of it, and to review the agreement that was reached by the council.
Maybe a little bit of the history of this. Several months ago, the town council condemned a building at 1231 Shore Road, commonly known as the Scout House. Subsequent to that action, the owner of the property, Stephen P. Virgilio, filed suit against the town of Cape Elizabeth, alleging that it was an improper decision, alleging that there would perhaps might have been some bias, and feeling that, you know, in general, like anyone does when they sue someone else, that it was an improper action. Subsequent to that, the town council reviewed the issue and met at a special meeting a half hour before one of their workshop meetings, a special meeting that was publicly advertised, and voted to give Dr. Virgilio sort of a stay whereby that he would have a certain time within which to apply for a building permit, and I think it was within 10 days of the date of the agreement, and then that the work would need to be substantially complete by December 31 of this year. I don't have any knowledge of whether or not he has in fact, one, signed the agreement, two applied for the building permit. I do know, looking at the property, that nothing's been done. I did drive by it today, and there's been no action, but I will check both with the town attorney and the building inspector tomorrow to find out what the status is. But that's what the council did.
Very much. Any other additions to the reports and correspondence section?
Just one personal comment. I'd like to express my personal appreciation to all the members of the council, to the staff, and to everyone else who's been so supportive during the past week after the death of my mother. It really does mean an awful lot to me.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Michael. And we do have Councilor Amaro, please.
I guess it's no surprise to anybody in Cape Elizabeth that the problems that the state is having with its budget is beginning to affect local budgets. And Michael was up at the hearing yesterday in Augusta, and I was as well, when municipal officials and school officials appeared before Appropriations Committee to really educate, I guess, the Appropriations Committee as to what all of the cuts in municipal revenue sharing, as well as the cuts in general purpose aid to education, would mean to local municipalities and local schools. And certainly Cape Elizabeth is not going to escape the effect of those cuts. We're still in a state of flux as to not knowing how the general purpose aid cuts will affect local communities, and whether there will be a straight 4% cut across all school districts, or whether there'll be some attempt to have a greater percentage increase on the low receiving districts, which we are, and a lesser percentage increase on the so-called poorer districts or higher receiving districts for state funds. So there's some work being done at that level. And as far as revenue sharing, it's been proposed that all revenue sharing be eliminated for the rest of this fiscal year. And Michael, what would be the effect on Cape Elizabeth if that did happen?
Yeah, I was going to discuss that with an agenda item later on, and we'll go into more detail on it at that point. But the town budget did budget $347,000 in state revenue sharing funds for the current fiscal year. During my absence this past week, Deborah Pizzo calculated that the revised amount that we would expect to receive is $181,000. Altogether, the budgeted revenue from all different sources was at $1,651,000. It now looks like we'll be receiving, this includes excise taxes, investment income, and everything else, $1,430,000. The difference between those amounts is $220,000. That's out of a total budget of $3.9 million. The municipal budget already this year was 8% below what it was the year before because of recognizing it was going to be a very difficult year for revenues. This latest cut in excise taxes is totally devastating. It's really going to be extremely difficult to find cuts during the middle of the fiscal year. If that's not, difficult enough, the governor has recommended suspending the state revenue sharing program. So it would not only be for this 6 months, but beyond that, for next fiscal year, we probably wouldn't be receiving any funds. At that point, would then be receiving the full impact of the loss of $347,000. Basically, the way this translates is we will have gone from a budget last year of just short of $4 million to an outlook of a possible budget next year of $3.3 million. That is by I think anyone's imagination or thought of just a tremendous, tremendous cut. I think everyone's going to really need to work together in a cooperative attitude. I met with the department heads this morning on it. Debbie met with them during this week in my absence, and the cuts are really going to hurt. They're really going to affect services, and what I'll be suggesting later on in the meeting, when the council gets to the item on the agenda, is that a public hearing be scheduled so that everyone is fully aware of the specifics of the cuts and has a chance to comment upon them. Thank you very much. Any other contributions at this time? Okay, we will conclude with reports and correspondence and begin now with our first of five public hearings this evening. The first being item number 88, and this is a hearing entitled Paputa Club Liquor License. This item considers approving a license for the Paputa Club as well as taking any necessary action. I will defer at this time to our town clerk, Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. You do have before you a renewal application from the Paputa Club for a full-time malt, spirituous, and vinous liquor license, plus their special amusement permit. The application has been completed. This public hearing was properly advertised. And Mr. Goforth, representing the Paputa Club, is here this evening. If you have any questions for him, I would recommend that you approve both applications.
Might I have a motion?
I'd like to ask a question.
Certainly.
Representative of Paputa Club.
Mr. Goforth, would you be kind enough to come up to the podium and just give us your official name here and your capacity at the club?
Yeah, my name's Greg Goforth, and I'm the manager of Paputa Club.
Thank you.
When a public body like the Cape Elizabeth Town Council or any local town council issues liquor licenses, it gives that public body an opportunity to look into the policies of a club, whether it be private or otherwise. I'd like to ask you what the policies are at the Paputa Club regarding the board of directors, how people become members of the board of directors, playing times for men as well as women, if playing times are different for women than they are for men, is there a difference in the fee charged, etc.? Those kinds of issues.
Okay. That sort of caught me unaware, and so I will try to do the best I can off the top of my head. I don't have anything with me as far as documentation. The board of directors are elected from the members of the club. Our annual meeting, as a matter of fact, is tomorrow night, where the board will be changing. There is a nominating committee who selects nominations for directors, which are then proposed to the membership. We take nominations from the floor at the annual meeting also, and then the directors are elected from that point. The officers of the organization are elected among the board of directors. They're not elected at large from the membership.
Could you tell me how many women are on the board of directors?
At this current time, there aren't any. We have the representative from the Paputa Women's Association, which is the women's organization within the club, does sit on all of the board, in on all of board meetings. The year before last, we did have one woman on the board, and she was on the board for a three-year term.
I guess the second issue, and this isn't an issue just for Cape Elizabeth, but this is an issue that's brought up across the country. Are there restrictions on the playing time for women as opposed to men?
There are two times during the week which are designated as women-only times and men-only times. The women only are allowed to play on Thursday up until 11 o'clock, and men only are allowed to play on Saturday up until 11 o'clock. Both of those times are restricted for outside guests. It's only stock-only members of the club that are allowed to play during those times. There's a further restricted time on Sunday, which is a stockholder-only time, and anyone with a full membership or the primary golfer of any membership is allowed from 7 to 9 on Sundays, which are our prime times. The stockholder in a family membership can be designated as either spouse. And there is a difference in fees also between the women and the men. There's a $100 difference, which is a historical difference between a single male membership and a single female membership.
Which one?
The women pay $100 less.
Thank you.
Any other questions or anybody?
Well, that's very helpful to get the policies and procedures, as long as we are endorsing to some extent the institution and authorizing the liquor license to be revised and put into effect. Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that the license be granted to the Papoota Club.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. Is there further discussion on the issue? All those in favor? Okay, it's a 7-0 vote, unanimous. Thank you very much. All right, we have our second public hearing tonight is entitled Vacate Paper Streets at Shore Acres. This is item number 89 in the council year. To consider vacating certain paper streets in the Shore Acres subdivision and take any necessary action. I have received a variety of pieces of correspondence with respect to this vacating motion. I'm not going to read them all, but I will note that I've received correspondence as chair of the council from Mr. James J. Kelly, from Alston B. and Isabel F. Hobby, from Carolyn M. Tucker, from Betty and Joseph Stocks, and from Cole Kelly. I don't know all of those people. I suspect many are in the audience this evening. And so why don't I basically ask our town manager to briefly present the issue, and then I will open up the public hearing to the public. Mr. Manager.
Yeah, thank you. I'll be very brief. This action comes before the town council as a result of a petition received from a number of folks who live in the area of Bayview, of the paper streets, Bayview Road and Katahdin Road Extension. Last month, a portion of the paper streets in this area were abandoned at the request of a petition received by a property owner, Martha Kelly. At this point in time, everyone that is in the subdivision has been sent a plan that shows essentially the area proposed to be abandoned, and as well as it shows, particularly shows the plan and the description of what would be abandoned. The process essentially would be following public comment, the council would take whatever action it deems to take.
Thank you very much. Michael, at this particular time, I will open this issue to public comment. Anyone in the audience this evening that would like to come down to the podium and offer input on this particular motion, could I see a hand or a indication that you would like to come down? Please. And if you'd be kind enough to just state your name and the address, that would be helpful to us.
My name is Mary Ann Doherty, and I live on 34 Trundy Road, and the paper streets do not directly affect me, but they direct a lot. They affect people that do live around me. And I just, some of the paper streets were abandoned in your last meeting, and I believe that was to help. The town doesn't really need those roads anymore. So I'm just encouraging the town to also abandon these roads as they did in their last meeting to the other paper streets that were abandoned. And I think that would be in the best interest of the town. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please, Mr. Kirstein.
Good evening. My name is Glenn Kirstein. I own property that abuts part of this paper road. And I'm here this evening only because I happen to be talking to both Wayne and Michael today when I heard that there was some opposition to this proposal. In Michael's comments, he indicated that the initial abandonment process of a month ago came as a result of a petition from a property owner. I don't believe you indicated how this particular process began. And having not heard any of the any citizens describe what their concerns were, perhaps you could either read the correspondence or summarize it for us. I have no problem with vacating those public ways. I guess I'm in favor of it. I'd be a larger landholder. Thank you.
Glenn, excuse me, which lot do you own?
The little triangular piece at the end on Trundy Road.
Lot number one of the subdivision?
The unbuildable lot that's only there to theoretically protect my view of the headlight.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Kirstein, I'd be happy to read through these five pieces of correspondence. I do see, the one on top is Mr. James Kelly. I do see Mr. Kelly in our second row. I don't want to put words in your mouth. Would it be possible for you to come up to the podium? And you have fairly succinctly summarized the problem with this motion, and I'd be delighted if you could present that summary to the group, Mr. Kelly.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your kind words. I appreciate your thinking that that my comments were clear. I wasn't sure that they were. My name is Jim Kelly. I live at 44 Trundy Road, and this is my wife, Martha. And she and I oppose this issue because, in our opinion, Katahdin Road Extension, which is the only portion of this that we oppose, is in fact not a paper street, but is in fact the end of the private road that we live on. And some time ago, the owners of Lot 42 elected to divert this road down through a driveway which they constructed on Lot 37 rather than have it go through their yard and continue on to Katahdin Road Extension. We feel that we've had discussions in the past about, by the way, let me say that during the hurricane, we were blocked off at our end of the road, and we needed to use this other end of the road to get out for several days. We've also had emergencies up there while we've lived there, where the only way that emergency vehicles could get in, because once again we were blocked down at our end, was through this other end. So we feel it's most important that this private road that we live on be open on both ends, as it shows on the map which you have in front of you, and as it currently is. It is our feeling that either the road should be reopened through Lot 42 and to Katahdin Road or Extension, or left as it is, whereby Katahdin Road Extension is not vacated, but is recognized to be the real end of the private road that we live on, and therefore the local agreement which exists, namely the diversion of that road down through Lot 37, which is really the Goldfines driveway and the Doherty driveway, I believe, is therefore the current end of that private road. And I would therefore, I don't know what ordinance you're using to vacate this, but if it's the true paper street ordinance, which is what we requested you used when you vacated very kindly at our request last month, then I would suggest to you that maybe this isn't really a vacated street, just one that hasn't been used for a while. I'm not here happy opposing something when we were here asking you to do something very similar for us in the past month. By the same token, I would submit to you that we were abutters of the road we asked you to vacate, and it's my understanding that two of your petitioners are not abutters of either of these, and therefore maybe you can see that there is some other motive here for them asking that this be, that Katahdin Road extension be vacated, in as much as they don't even abut it. So possibly their thinking is exactly along the lines of our concerns. We do not have any quarrel whatsoever with vacating the rest of Bayview, which goes out past the triangle that gentleman spoke of. I would also tell you that I have tried to contact at least one of the petitioners on this issue to sit down and see if we could in fact work something out, but I was advised that wasn't something they really wanted to do. So we would request that you not vacate Katahdin Road extension.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. The town manager does have a question for you, please.
Sure. Yeah. We always have concern with public access to particular areas, particularly for public safety vehicles. When I reviewed this with the fire chief many months ago now, he felt that there was no reason for it to be retained by the community. However, you mentioned that, you know, as a result of the recent storm, that your access way was blocked. You also mentioned that you needed to use the other way. However, looking at this, as I understand it, having looked at the land, the paper street section is not the way you got out during the storm, is it?
Exactly.
I don't want to leave it unclear for the council.
No.
The paper street section is not improved and is not passable.
No, but
so
at
this
one,
would not resolve at, that problem unless it was later constructed.
Exactly. At one time, that was the way out. We went down through the driveway through lot 37. In the past 15 years since we have lived there, from time to time, it has been suggested to us by the owners of the driveway through lot 37 that we had no rights to use it. And we said, well, then that's fine. Let us just extend the road back to where it was, and we will use that. And then the discussion got to one of, well, we prefer not to do that because it then goes right through our right past the front of our house, so why don't you go ahead and continue to use our driveway if you have to. Basically, the agreement we have is we don't use it if we don't have to, and they don't come down our end if they don't have to, but from time to time, both ends have to use the other end. So until we either work something out or leave it as it is, I think that the only reason that we can use driveway 30 through lot 37 when it's necessary or in an emergency is by virtue of the fact that by rights we ought to be going down through lot 42 and out Katahdin Road extension. We're more than happy to try and work something out. What we'd like to do, in fact, if they want to block it off and eliminate it, is truly block it off. We'll block it off at the end of where we all use it, and they can figure out how they're going to get in and out of their end, and we'll figure out how we're going to get in and out of our end. The problem is one of maintenance. We maintain our end, and so it's just local problems and issues that we're more than willing to work out, but it's kind of been one-sided so far.
Well, thank you, Mr. Kelly. Mr. Kirstein, does that help?
The council received a petition signed by Penelope Carson, one of the owners of the subdivision, by Tina Fisher Dark Goldfine, I think that's the name, and by a couple of residents on Highview Road, which is below this, the Lampshires, and is there one other on Highview? In the Hosmers. And the Ospangs.
So there was a formal petition that was received by the council. Please, why don't you, sir? Go right ahead, Councilor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jim, I want to make sure I understand the history here, because I did come up and cruise around these private roads the other day. So if you saw that strange car, that was me, folks, trying to figure out what was going on. If you're sitting up at the top, okay, I want to ask you that one. The private way that's shown on the map that we have, and I assume you have, going over to Katahdin Extension. Did you used to be able to traverse all the way over to Katahdin Extension and then down to Trundy Road?
At one time, that is correct. That was the way in and out of the back road there, and there was no driveway through Lot 37.
Coming down, okay.
So everybody on that back road either went in and out Katahdin Road Extension or went in and out...
Down by your house.
Wombeck or whatever that is down at the other end.
Okay, and right now the conditions are that what's labeled here Katahdin Road Extension just before Mrs. Petrelick's house is grass. It looks like it's wide enough for a road, but it's grassed in now.
Right.
Then down back between that property and the back Goldfine property is on, look to me like a fairly steep slope that's all trees now.
You vacated that last month.
No. Between lots 36 and 42.
Oh, I'm sorry. Between lots 36 and 42.
Yeah, I didn't vacate
that
one.
That's just the continuation of the private way.
But that's where you used to be able to drive through, and now it's all trees.
Exactly.
How long ago was this?
20 years ago.
Okay, that explains the stand of trees there. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Kelly? Councilor Cogsell.
On your private way, that's a deeded way for all of the abutters, or just for your lot?
I honestly don't know if it's deeded or not. The only people that usually use it are those that live on that road and abut it. But I'm not sure that it's only the abutters, for example, who have rights to it. That I don't know. I know it's only the abutters who primarily use it, and it is only the abutters who maintain it.
Who maintain it.
Yes.
I'm just concerned with Katahdin Extension, which is an approved town way if it were developed. We abandoned that. We don't know what status these other people would have for egress, do we?
The town has never taken a position on who has rights within the public way, the private way, excuse me. That's considered to be a private matter between all of the different folks there. From time to time, a number of individuals, probably about a half a dozen over the last 10 years or so, have spoken to me and to my predecessor about it, and each time we've gone out and looked at it, but we take the position that it's a private issue that really doesn't have anything to do with the town.
And I would suggest that is exactly the way all of us feel, but it carries down through Katahdin Road Extension as well. And until and if we work it out, I would suggest it would not be right to vacate Katahdin Road Extension. That in fact is not a paper street, just a private way that hasn't been used for quite some time.
And if the council does not take any action, my understanding is that you better have it worked out by 1997, because it will happen automatically then.
Well, if it's a paper street, it will. If it's not, if it doesn't meet the definition of a paper street, it's my understanding that it won't.
Okay.
But I'm not an attorney, but that's my understanding.
Any further clarification for Mr. Kelly? Okay. Please, would you come right down to the podium? And would you be kind enough to state your name and your address?
I'm Pete Lampshire. We're one of the petitioners on Highview. And which is, of course, unfortunately doesn't show on your map here, but there are three of us property owners that are probably where your map blips, Bayview and at the foot of Katahdin Extension. I don't know where Katahdin Extension begins and ends, frankly. But we are down there, Osbacks, Lampshire's, Hosmer's, and I guess there's one other property owner. The thing that I don't understand with Mr. Kelly has been talking about here on Katahdin Extension is we've lived there for 23 years, and we have never seen any kind of vehicle in that 23 years that has used that stretch of, whatever you want to call it, paper street between Trundy on down at all. That road, there has never been anything that's passable since we have lived here. It's not passable today, and it has not been passable for 23 years at least.
The issue, it could be passable if the trees were cut down.
Well, I'm just saying it hasn't ever been used for 23 years is all I'm saying. So whatever this problem is, which I don't fully understand, I'm sorry to say, about the private road here and so forth, for 23 years, that problem has taken care of itself, and I guess Mr. Kelly alluded to that one way or another. And this Katahdin Extension paper street has not been involved. And I don't know whether it's ever been involved. And it very well could have earlier than that, before we moved there, before there was growth. I think a lot of those homes, at least the homes in our area, were built about that time. But since we have lived there, whatever the problem with the private road access to Trundy has been resolved without using the so-called Katahdin Extension.
Well, thank you very much for your input. Is there further input that would be helpful to us this evening on this particular public hearing? Yes, would you come down, please?
My name is William Hosmer. I live at 38 Highview Road, next to the Lampshans. I've lived here 18 years. I have approximately 305 feet that is next to, adjacent to, abuts the paper street. It's my recommendation that you vacate it. The reason I have is that I have had difficulties with people who want to cut trees down or who have cut the tops of trees down in that area. From my property, which is next to the Lampshans, up to the triangle, it is all trees. It is a tree belt. And my desire is to protect it as a tree belt. And therefore, I ask you to vacate it, and it would be my purpose to buy it if I could. But my purpose is to protect an area that has been depredated in the past. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any need for clarification? Thank you. Other input?
Just to clarify one point, if it was vacated, title, any section that is vacated, title automatically would pass along the center line of the paper street to the abutters on either side. So in essence, the paper street would be divided with one abutter owning half of it and the other abutter owning the other half.
And what would be the issue with respect to cost to that abutter?
There would be no cost.
There'd be no cost at all. Further input. Seeing none, I will close the public portion of the public hearing at this particular time and call for discussion from my fellow counselors on this issue.
Mr. Chairman?
Councilor Chappell.
I've had numerous calls on this situation up there, living on Trundy Road myself. And after looking it all over, walking it, talking with pretty near everybody from the triangle down, I'm sorry I didn't get down behind, but I use this area up here. I didn't get down to you. I don't think that I could vote for, at this present time, for doing away with Katahdin, the extension. I see no fault with doing away with the rest of Bayview. Now, that's from the people I've talked to, and I can't see why we as a council right now want to upset any can of worms in an area when, in my honest opinion, it's up to the people that live in that area to get together and and work this out, because as Michael has said, the council itself has nothing to do whatsoever with private ways. Those are put on a map by the developer to take care of the people both sides, and are put on there for a reason. We can't vacate them, we can't move them, we can't do anything with them. And I think for the time being, the end of that private way should connect with something on both ends. That's my personal opinion. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Councilor Jordan.
I don't know that anybody here could answer my question. Maybe Jim Kelly or one of them could. But I understand years ago there used to be a summer water main that come in Bayview and go over to, well, I understand as of now, to Lot 43. Is that still active, or is that disbanded?
You want me to answer that?
Please. If you...
Yes, that... There is a water main that does come in Katahdin Road Extension and comes through that portion of Bayview that you vacated last month to that Katahdin Road Extension intersection. And it's my understanding that the water district so noted that and simply requested that they have a continuing easement along that area that was vacated, and I would just assume that that would happen as part of the action. It does only serve lot number 43, and those are the Kellys, that the Cole Kellys that you referred to, and I know that they are working on getting their own source one way or another anyway, so I don't think that's going to be a problem forever. But it does come in Katahdin Road Extension, yes.
It comes in Katahdin Road Extension, but not in Bayview off of Trundy Road.
That's correct.
It goes from Katahdin Road Extension onto Bayview up to the Kelly property.
That's correct.
Is that right?
That's correct.
If I may, while you're still there, Mr. Chairman.
Certainly.
His driveway on the Lot 43, how does he get out? Does he come over and down by 37?
No.
No?
He comes down past 44, 45, and then out onto Trundy Road. Normally, from Lot 43, 44, and 43, 44, 45 are the ones that primarily use the east end of the private way. Lot 42, 37. Use the west end of that private way primarily.
And I understand it now in listening to the people of Highview that they come up and border.
I suspect they border Bayview.
Bayview.
That portion that you are also considering vacating.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Appreciate it. And I'm also opposed to abandoning Katahdin Road Extension. I think that should stay there, and I've talked to the owner of Lot 36, and he isn't too concerned about it one way or the other. But she says that in the time that she's lived there, that it was used at one time, but it hasn't been for quite a number of years now. But she remembers when it was used. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Other input on this issue? I myself don't feel comfortable voting to support this vacating motion this evening, and personally would prefer to see this motion die. I think that it's created a lot of animosity to some extent. It seems to me that those 10 lots have been living in peace in some fashion, the private way, although you either have a choice of getting out the west end or the east end. Everyone seems to be living in a rather friendly fashion there, and it seems that to vacate Katahdin is clearly going to invoke the ire of at least some individuals as a consequence of a feeling that there will be some kind of loss of
egress. So that is my particular position on the issue prior to the vote. Councilor Amaro.
Well, I think the issue of Katahdin Road is, extension is separate because it's not really clear to me that that is a paper road. I think there's some question there. But I don't see any problem with vacating the other section of Bayview Road. I haven't heard anybody speak in opposition to it. In fact, only people speaking really in favor of it. So I guess I would like to move that we vacate the, I don't have the particulars in front of me, but that extension of Bay Road, which was set for public hearing this evening.
Second.
It's on the draft motion from the town attorney's office, it's the third, one. Okay, there's a motion on the table here in a second. I will ask for further discussion, and in the context of asking for that, provide some. There is one of the five letters, perhaps I was remiss in not being more specific, but the Carolyn M. Tucker letter does strongly object to our proposal to vacate Bayview Road in the town of Cape Elizabeth. Apparently, Carolyn Tucker is the owner of 11-plus acres adjacent to the road in question, and because of the short notice, she has not had sufficient time to review with her attorneys the impact that this proposed action would have on her particular property. So I would be remiss if I didn't mention just that issue.
Mr. Chairman, I understand that the property that she owns is on the section of Bayview that we vacated last 2 months ago.
Okay, I'm not sure. I don't have her lot number. I just... Mrs. Tucker owns most of the People's Cove section. Particularly, she owns a lot of the land behind Lot 46, as shown on the plan, which is the lot owned by Sarah Kelly.
Okay. So your point, Councilor Amaro, is that letter really would not apply to the section of Bayview we're anticipating vacating this evening?
That's right.
Thank you for the clarification. Okay, that was the only specific mention of that I had in the correspondence. Further discussion, Councilor Cogsell.
I have a question for Mr. McGovern. In the facts that we received from our attorney, there were three separate sections that were listed.
Yes.
For the vacation. One was the Katahdin Road, the other was the portion of Bayview Road that deals with a motion that Councilor Amaro made. What is this other number two, an unnamed road?
The other one, trying to, Mrs. Tucker was in today, and she had an old plan of the People's Cove section as well as Eastfield. And apparently there is a second Shore Acres plan which shows another paper street that cuts across the Sarah Kelly property, connecting a portion of Bayview Road that was abandoned with the People's Cove area. And while, you know, she indicated she has no plans for developing it, you know, she did mention emergency access and other issues of concern, but again, she, you know, emphasized once again, you know, for that particular section that she would hope the council would not do a whole lot. But this is the, you know, my recollection, having looked at the plan when she was in around noon today, is it goes right through the middle of Lot 46. It kind of goes in and then it branches out in both directions. It's not shown on any of our assessor's maps or anything.
Okay, so it has not been a town accepted plan, is that possible, or a town accepted road?
The paralegal who looked at it in the town attorney's office feels that it is a paper street that is on an approved plan. Nonetheless, no one has petitioned that particular section. There is not a public hearing set on it, and, you know, it would not be in order to deal with it.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. I have no problem with supporting the vacation of this section of Bayview Road ahead of us, in front of us somewhere tonight. I'm seeing the Kellys looking puzzled about this unnamed road, and I'm sure they'll be looking into it. Have you ever heard of it, right? But I don't see any problem with Bayview Road. I think with both instances, we're stepping into the middle of potentially neighborhood hornet nests and have no desire to do that. I'm hearing about the cutting of trees in the Bayview Road area. That is something that I certainly hope the neighbors there will work out cooperatively. I know people, as Mr. Kirstein said, he has that, what shows on here, that little triangular lot one for his view. And it's a wonderful view from up there. That, I assume, is why people have been cutting the trees. I wasn't.
So noted.
But I think, you know, people, the abutters have to be aware of this and be careful in establishing where the new property lines would be at the center line of that paper street. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Counselor. Further input during this discussion? Could I have the town clerk read the motion?
That portion of Bayview Road which runs from the northerly terminus of Katahdin Road to the westerly terminus of the portion of Bayview Road which was vacated by order of the Town of Cape Elizabeth dated October 16, 1991. Said portion of Bayview Road is also described as being located northerly and westerly of lots 131, 132, and 133, as shown on the plan of Shore Acres recorded in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds in Plan Book 12, page 45.
Okay, there is a motion, a second. I will ask for a vote at this time. All those in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The vote is 6-1. Okay, the next item on our agenda is public hearing number 3, entitled Affordable Housing Amendments. This is item 90, and this is to consider approving proposed amendments to the Code of Ordinance relating to affordable housing and to take any necessary action. At this time, I will defer to the chairperson of our Ordinance Committee, Councilor Cogsell.
Thank you. Last month, I read in its entirety the new affordable housing amendment to the zoning ordinance. This is one of the requirements of the state in order to have our comprehensive plan approved. This is a result of many years of work from a special affordable housing joint committee with Yarmouth and Cape Elizabeth, and then our own affordable housing committee, with their report from 1989, as well as at least a year's worth of work from the ordinance committee and then our own, the planning board and then our own ordinance committee. Do you want me to go into any more detail?
Well, you've certainly given a summary, and the last council meeting, we had a very extensive presentation of this particular issue. I don't think you have to go into any more detail. What I might do at this point is perhaps ask our town planner to come up to the podium and add any particular pertinent items that she may feel would be helpful for clarification purposes to our citizens.
There's a dual approach in the ordinance that's proposed before you in order to provide affordable housing in Cape Elizabeth. The first approach is to require that 10% of new subdivisions include affordable housing. The other way of doing it, which is also provided for in the amendments in front of you, is to provide developers who are willing to develop a 100% affordable subdivision with some density bonuses. They would be allowed to have smaller lots in exchange for putting aside more of the land for open space. I'm available for any other questions.
Thank you, Ms. O'Mara. Are there any particular questions at this time for our town planner? And I will, at this time, open this up to the public with respect to the fact that it is a public hearing. Are there
input from anyone in the audience that would be pertinent to this particular issue on affordable housing amendments? Seeing none, I will close this portion of the public hearing. Any further discussion on the council with regard to these very well thought out amendments? Seeing none, oh, I'm sorry.
I was just going to make a motion.
I was going to ask for one.
You have it. That I move that the town council adopt the affordable housing amendments as presented.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
No discussion.
I'm sorry, we had our discussion. I thought we had two sections of discussion. It was a unanimous vote. Did you want to make a...
No, well, I just a comment that I can't believe that there were no comments on the affordable housing amendments, and that this was such a hot issue about 3 years ago. And maybe it's just taken us so long to get the ordinance in place that everybody's gotten tired of the subject. Are all the houses in Cape Elizabeth are getting affordable? I don't know what the, what the reason is, but it's very interesting that nobody showed up to speak to this item. That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, Councilor Amaro. We've tried very hard to get the press herald to publish public hearings when we do have our council meetings, but that's a fairly arbitrary decision on the part of the newspaper as to whether they'll publish them or not. And unfortunately, not only were not the public hearings published this week, but the meeting of the council in general wasn't published this week. So we just didn't really luck out, unfortunately, although that information is certainly goes to who it should go to. But I share in your concerns. Okay. I counted a unanimous vote. Do we want to vote again on that issue to be crystal clear? All those in favor? Okay, the vote is 7-0. It is a unanimous vote with respect to these affordable housing amendments. Thank you. The fourth public hearing this evening is on leaf burning. This is item 91. And we are to consider public comments on leaf burning and take any necessary action. This issue is similar to the dog issue. It seems to come up every two or three years. It's come up recently as a consequence of one of the citizens being annoyed at a situation that took place with leaf burning. And what I will do for the public here is basically read the section of Article 1 on the Fire Prevention Code of Cape Elizabeth. This is Section 8 of our town ordinances, 8-2, and specific Section 8-1-4, entitled Open Burning. Section F-301.3 is amended to read, Open burning shall be allowed after obtaining a permit or other proper authorization from the fire chief for recognized silvicultural or range or wildlife management practices, prevention or control of disease or pests, this is the key part, for limited leaf and brush burning by individual citizens and for the burning of demolition debris at the municipal refuse disposal area. That is the particular section that is applicable at this time in Cape Elizabeth. We have the issue come up this evening as a consequence of a particular citizen, I don't feel it's proper to mention the name, indicating that on a given date a particular leaf burning situation seemed to drag on throughout the day into the wee hours of the evening, when the permit was only valid from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And this has I can't resist. This has sparked the item being on our agenda this evening with regard to public hearing status. So I will ask for, I couldn't resist, I will ask for input from the public at this time. Please, anyone?
Just if I could make one comment, Leland P. Murray, who is the acting fire chief, is present this evening, should any members of the public have questions for the chief.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone in the audience? Please come right down. Please come right down. And would you be kind enough to state your name and your address, please?
I'm Sophie Caracas. I live at 72 Stony Brook Road in Cape Elizabeth. I was absolutely delighted to read in the Cape Courier that this was an issue. I find it very disturbing that after all these years, with all that we have done in Cape Elizabeth, that we still allow leaf burning or any kind of burning. First of all, we try everything we can in our community to make it, to make everybody aware of environmentally, to take care of our waste. We have a wonderful disposal area here that is wonderful to go to and dispose of anything you want to. And I can't imagine that we're still allowing people to burn in the streets when we have health hazards. I'll tell you, if you come anywhere in Cape Elizabeth when people are burning leaves, you can't keep a window open. If the air pressure is such, it hovers for hours and hours and hours. If they don't put it out, if it's such a bonfire of leaves, that it smolders the next day continuously. And I don't think this is right, because today, I've lived here, what, for 26 years? Okay, 26 years ago, we didn't have the awareness. Our awareness wasn't peaked to know what a health hazard it is. And it really is a hazard to people who have to breathe this. Regardless of how short a period it is, it's a health hazard. And it shouldn't be allowed. I don't like to have to close my windows. I don't like to have it be where I have to turn on my lights to go through a street because somebody is burning the whole length of their property, be it 200 feet, and they're burning along. And I don't think that's safe. Far be it from us to have anything happen like it did in California and Oakland. But we can have that kind of a problem, too, on a dry season, if it's windy, if it gets out of hand. It can spread, especially the way our beautiful community is set up. And though I feel very strongly, like I said before, I was absolutely thrilled to see that it's an issue, seeing it's, and that's why I came, and I hope that you do stop it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Other input, please.
My name is Tom Heels, and I've lived at 9 Rocky Knoll Road for the last 19 and a half years. And I am very pleased to be in front of the town council tonight, and very pleased that this is on the agenda, because smoke has bothered us in this neighborhood for years. We came back to Cape Elizabeth after being away for 3 years in Elissa County, in a town there where smoking burning is not allowed. And to come back to Cape Elizabeth in the fall of 88 and be faced with the clouds of smoke that we've had to put up with was just unbelievable. And for a progressive community like Cape Elizabeth, I'm very astonished that it's still allowed. Because the Surgeon General has said many years ago that smoking was hazardous to your health. That's not just cigarette smoke. That's vagrant smoke outside. In our neighborhood, over the last 19 and a half years, we've had one fire that got out of control with the leaves that were not extinguished at the end of the fire burning time. Those leaves burned and were blown into a garage, and that garage went up in flames, and without the help of the fire department, that house would have been lost, and a loss of life, perhaps. So this is not a joking issue or a trivial issue, I don't believe. Also, in our neighborhood on Oakhurst, there was smoke so thick one time that a car coming down Oakhurst hit a child. So if you have small children playing outside, which we don't happen to have at our age, but there are small children in the neighborhood, it can be extremely hazardous to small children. It's definitely a matter of public safety. And everybody in Cape Elizabeth would be very, very happy, I think, with a smoke-free environment. We have written a number of letters over the last 3 years, my wife and I, to both the town manager and the fire chief, and your letter was probably the one that you alluded to. Am I correct?
Yes, it was, sir.
Would you like me to read it to the audience? I would like to...
If you'd like to read it, I think you should read it.
Yes, I would. The letter is dated September 16th, and I might add that there's been two serious fires since then and back to the rear of our property, which we've not complained about. But every fire in that neighborhood is a complaint to us and a nuisance to us, which is against the laws of open burning, because the burning says, burning is permitted as long as no nuisance is created. Every time there's an outdoor fire, there's a nuisance, in my opinion. I can't stand the smoke. I don't like it in my house. I don't like it anywhere. On September 16th, I wrote a letter to the town manager. Yesterday, the fire department issued a burning permit to William Riley of Hillcrest Road. The fire was to the rear of our property on 9 Rocky Knoll Road, and we first observed the fire upon returning from church at about 12:30 p.m. The fire was still burning at 10 p.m. with visible flames. This morning, the fire was still smoldering. We closed all our windows to keep out the smoke, to keep the smoke all day. It was a nuisance. This morning, upon calling Chief Webster and informing him that the fire was not out, he said the permit was only valid from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Why was the fire continuing to burn until late into the night? This neighborhood has had one garage burned down as a result of debris from a fire blowing around and catching it on fire. Who watches over these fires? It's obvious nobody does. I have written the neighbors and the fire chief in October of 89, and I wrote you twice before in November of 1990 and December of 1990. Your latest letter to me stated that, quote, it is regretful that your neighbors have not been cooperative. Please let me know specifically the neighbors who are causing the problems. I wish to work with the fire chief in writing to the neighbors to inform them that any future complaints will result in no future fire permits being issued. End quote. I wrote you as requested, giving names and addresses, yet the problem still persists after 3 long years. Did you write to the neighbors? Why are they still allowed to burn when they violate the law? There are other people in the neighborhood who are allergic to smoke, and I am at a loss as to why these people are allowed to continue to torment us. We have spoken to them in person, written to them, all to no avail. In fact, it appears to us that the more we voice our concerns, the more determined they are to ignore them. The place where they have elected to burn has become their year-round open burning dump instead of just a place to burn leaves in the fall. The fire yesterday burned with flames through pouring rain, suggesting that the material was somehow prepared for long-term burning. A large amount of smoke was rising from the site this morning. All we asked at the past, and all we still ask, is that fire be moved away from our home, which due to its location on a knoll, acts as a chimney, filling our home with smoke. We look forward to the day when all outdoor burning is banned. Sincerely, Thomas Heels. And I sent a copy of that to the fire chief. I did receive, I believe you did write me a letter, or as a result of that letter, it did get on a meeting earlier, and it's on the agenda tonight, which I'm very pleased that it's come to this head after 3 long years. And I'm very strongly against outdoor leaf burning, and I think everybody in Cape Elizabeth would be better off without it. And I support an ordinance to ban leaf burning outdoors.
Thank you, Mr. Heels.
Thank you very much.
Other input from the public.
I'm Carol Fritz, Stirrup Road. I'd like to urge the council to I don't know if the process is to remove the brush and leaf burning permits that are allowed out of the fire prevention code, but I'd like to urge you to prohibit the burning of leaves and brush. I think there's a lot of nostalgia and remembering childhood when we used to burn leaves, the nice smell that some people feel, the reason we've continued this, but I think in this day and age we really know better than to continue to have open burning the way we are. It just is not good for health reasons that other people have mentioned. We're aware of greenhouse effects and the burning of organic things. But I also think of leaves and brush as a real resource, that it's just foolish to burn it. Leaves, when they're broken down into organic matter, are soil additives that are good to use if you have a backyard compost pile. Use it when you plant new shrubbery. Work it into the garden. Some farmers work it into the soil. It means that you don't need to have nearly as many pesticides because it doesn't run off. You don't lose, have the ups and downs when you have ups and downs in rainfall. There are just lots of benefits for that, using that organic matter. We also provide lots and lots of options for people. They don't need to burn leaves. There's all kinds of fancy things in the stores. There are people who will go out and train you to make backyard compost piles. You don't have to be fancy about a compost pile. You can just put up a little fence and let it sit there for 3 years, which is what I do. I am a lazy composter, and 3 years later I move it down to the garden. I mean, there are really options, and then certainly we have the leaf and brush area at the town transfer station, and it's really good, I think, that the public works people at the transfer area are now moving leaves and brush and grass clippings that have finished composting up so that they're available for people to haul away. So we get a circle of use. So I would like to suggest that it's just foolish to continue burning leaves, that there are lots of options for people, and that you prohibit and look into an ordinance to do that, or whatever the mechanism is. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Fritz. Other input, please.
Ed Dilworth, and I live on Clinton Road in Cape Elizabeth. I would like to see the burning permits continue. I have 4.5 acres of land. I take pride in taking care of it, raking the leaves, getting them into piles, and burning them by the pond that I have out there. In the last few storms, a lot of the trees have come down, and in cutting them up, it's very difficult to haul that to the dump. If the town wanted to pick it up by roadside, try to find a way to get it to the roadside. But I would really like to be able to have a burning permit occasionally to burn the leaves and the slash and so forth that I accumulate on a year-to-year basis. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Please.
My name is Mary Drake, and I live at 11 Rocky Knoll Road, and Tom Heels, my neighbor who lives at 9 Rocky Knoll Road, spoke so eloquently about our concerns, but I'll speak about mine particularly because I'm the allergic person to whom he refers, and I have allergy injections, which I have to have year-round on a monthly basis because of all these allergies I have, and specifically to leaf burning. So over the years, I've been very concerned about the continuation of this burning permit, and I'm really very anxious from my health standpoint for the leaf burning to be banned, so that it will eliminate at least one concern of mine, this health hazard that the smoke has, and that's basically why I wasn't really prepared to speak tonight, but I have to tell you, it's really, it's very hard to have these, this smoke being, that each fall, that, and we have one neighbor in particular to whom we have spoken. I think that's maybe one of the issues, is the fact that we speak to this neighbor and our concerns are ignored, and that's, so I'm very anxious for the leaf burning to be banned, and I thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Other input? Seeing none, I will close the public portion of this particular hearing on leaf burning and open up the issue to the council. I would only remind all of us that should the feeling of the council be to change this policy, we would be essentially referring this issue back to the ordinance committee for the ordinance committee to rework the language that would be required to alter the current policy. That would be the mechanism that some of you have alluded to this evening. Chairman, chairperson of the ordinance committee, Councilor
Cogswell. I'm not volunteering for work. I just have a question. When a, I don't know if I should ask this of Mr. McGovern or of the acting fire chief, when a person comes in for a burning permit, are there any criteria that I use before it's issued? Weather
yes.
conditions, neighborhood conditions? Could you tell the audience what those yeah. are?
Neighborhood conditions is not one of the factors. Do you want to answer the question, Mr. Murray? Chief, would you come down to the podium and perhaps offer some of your own thoughts on this issue?
I knew you wanted to.
I'm Jim Murray, acting fire chief. In answer to your question, Phyllis, on what is required, like Mr. Heel said, the permit is from 9 to 3, and you are required to have either a hose or brooms or shovel or some equipment, and it's to be attended while it's being burnt. In answer to my feelings on it, I feel both ways. Number one, I agree with Mr. Heels that if you have a problem in an area like he sounds like he does have, and the smoke does become a problem, I agree with him wholeheartedly that he has a right to have that control, either through a call to the police department, which they would come down and check it, or a call to the fire department, at which time they'd come down and check it. And if there was a problem, I certainly would agree with him that the fire should be put out if the smoke is causing some problems. In answer to Ed Dilworth, in a situation where he lives, there is an area there where he can burn and burn safe and burn without creating a problem of smoke and nuisance. So I think there's two ways of looking at it. Mr. Heel with a problem of smoke, and Ed with plenty of room to do what he wants to do. So I that's my feelings on it.
Thank you very much, Chief. I appreciate that.
Go ahead. I'll yield to the leader.
Councilor McLaughlin, Chief, would you please come right back there?
Chief
Thank
Murray,
you.
Just help educate me. How often, when you're burning leaves, is that? My experience has been you always get smoke.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen a leaf fire that doesn't smoke?
Not very often. But we do have in answer to the other conditions, we do have weather and wind conditions where we do not issue permits.
Have you ever issued permits, to your knowledge, that do not extend from 9 to 3 or maybe a shorter time period? I mean, our weather conditions change so rapidly.
Yeah, you know, if the wind comes up, they should be put out, and this it can be a problem, okay? A call can be made, that the wind condition is in, and of course sometimes there are 10, 15, 20 burner permits issued in a day. Mm-hmm. That call can go out to extinguish them. Okay. And certainly if somebody is burning after 3 o'clock in the afternoon, it should be extinguished.
Usually when someone goes to the dispatcher for a burning permit, they're asked, what time do you plan to burn? And, you know, they can say they'll be done at noon, and usually then they give them a permit for 1 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, it's...
Okay.
It isn't just a blanket permit from 9-3.
Okay, my understanding, I misunderstood that then.
Okay.
Thank you.
Counselor Jordan.
Yes. I am concerned. I agree with what these people about the leaf burning, and in these built-up neighborhoods, there is a problem because leaf burning is, smokes more than it really burns. It smolders away, and but I would hope that we could write an ordinance so that anybody with some acreage around would be able to burn up some slash and different things without being tied to a blanket burning in Cape Elizabeth, period. Because I think there is some landowners around here that do own land enough that could do some burning without creating a problem. And the problem with the leaf burning's gone on for years and years, and I can remember when I could look from the house and see Brentwood Acres is nothing but a cloud of smoke. And they have curtailed that a little bit, and there's not so many people burning now as they did years ago. Some of them are hauling them to the transfer station to get away from that, standing there stirring the leaves and trying to get them to burn, but there is a few people that still like to burn. And I've had two or three calls that would like to be able to continue leaf burning, but their areas that where I got the call from had acreage enough so they don't interfere, they're not burning somebody's back door yard. And we've been over that for years. And they are issued to a certain length of time, but if anyone are burning in the evening, I say the neighbors or somebody should have called, because I think it's a requirement that they are to be attended and they can be fined for it. So I don't understand why it wasn't pushed, and probably nobody wanted to push the issue is why they never called and asked why they burned them, because the fire department could come there and put them out and they can be fined for not attending the fire.
Well, is anyone interested in making a motion at this time, seeing no further discussion?
I'll make a motion. We refer this to the ordinance committee.
I'll second that.
There is a motion and a second. Is there discussion on that? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Chief. The issue will be referred to the ordinance committee, and hopefully a reworking of the ordinance will take place prior to the next burning season. Thank you very much. There's a...
Oh, yes.
Yes, it will. Yes, it will indeed. We'll come back to public hearing. Chief. Well, I would hope that in the context of the work of the Ordinance Committee, Public Works would be solicited, and as well as the Fire Department and appropriate other municipal bodies to really try to fine-tune a reworking of the ordinance. Thank you. Okay, let us move to our fifth and final public hearing for the evening. And this is entitled General Assistance Ordinance. This is item number 92, to consider a proposed general assistance ordinance and take any particular action. We have the lengthy ordinance from our last month's packet, and I will at this time defer to our town manager to review the issue.
Yes, the Maine Municipal Association sends us each year a draft general assistance ordinance, which intends to incorporate the statutes that have been enacted by the previous legislature. There, at this point, there isn't much leeway in what you can do. However, the governor's speech of last Wednesday night emasculates, if I can use that word again, the general assistance program. They're totally confused as to what they're proposing. No one seems to know what's up, so you'll probably have another general assistance ordinance before you in the next 2 months based on whatever the legislature does between now and next, by the end of the year. But that's where this comes from.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Despite that, we do have a general assistance ordinance before us tonight, prepared by the Maine Municipal Association, and actually, the cover letter, it's actually a state document, and we need to make a decision on that. I would entertain a motion, please. I need to open this issue to the public. It is a public hearing, and I will so do that. Are there any individuals in the audience this evening that would like to speak on the general assistance ordinance as presented to us this evening? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and again refer this issue back to the council. Is there any particular discussion, or please, Councilor Amaro?
Is there any need to have to pass this tonight, or can we table this until we need more information?
Under the current state law, this should be adopted.
Should be? Or has to be?
Well, I don't think the state is going to come enforcing it in the next month, but it is the law of the land currently.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I looked it over and see if I qualified, and I didn't understand it when I got done whether I would or wouldn't. But if we don't really have to adopt it, and you, in your opening remarks, indicated that it might be something else coming along, a change and what have you, what if we did just table it into a meeting or two or something to that effect? Will there be any crime involved if we did that?
I think that was yes, there would be. That was the point I was trying to make.
Thank you. I'll move the adoption.
Second.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. That concludes the public hearing portions of our agenda this evening. At this time, I'd like to continue on in our agenda items to item number 93. This is to consider the report of the School Space Study Committee and to take any necessary action. And I would ask the chairman of this group, Mr. Jeffrey White, if he would be kind enough to come down to the podium and give us a summary of his work. I would also mention that there has been a very comprehensive presentation of this executive summary in a joint Town Council School Board workshop that took place a couple of weeks ago. I guess it was about the 29th of September.
You are correct as usual.
Something like that, anyway. So we will ask for a summary for the viewers this evening and those present here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll make my comments very brief in light of the fairly lengthy discussion we had at the workshop a couple of weeks ago, which I know was aired several times for the benefit of those in the community. Basically, this committee was organized by the Town Council and the School Board. It spent the better part of 11 months reviewing carefully the school system, the buildings that we have in the school system, particularly the middle school building and the Pond Cove school buildings, given that the high school is considerably newer and in much better shape than those buildings. We had two components of our study. The first was to look at the physical condition of the buildings, determine what needs existed for rehabilitation or renovation, and to make recommendations concerning that. And then the second was to focus on how our school system will deal with the anticipated additional students that are coming into the system over the next 5 or 6 years, and to consider alternatives to where we might put classes of students in various buildings. Basically, working with the Portland design team, our report recommends several things. First, that a detailed look, a more extensive look, be taken at the need to rehabilitate the middle school and Pond Cove buildings. And on that point, I think we simply recommend that the school board, working with the Town Council, develop in more detail the plans and recommendations of the report, and particularly focus on phasing that would be necessary for the renovation of the Pond Cove and the middle school buildings over time. With regard to the second part of the report that deals with various options, and we made four recommendations for various grade groupings in the Pond Cove middle school and high school buildings, taking advantage of the space that was in them. I think it's the, I know it is the committee's feeling that the school board in particular ought to consider those options at length with appropriate public input from the citizens in the town, and to come to some consensus on which one of them they feel is the best combination of benefit to our town, cost, and best balances the school programming, school policy, and social policy issues that are inherent in them. With that very brief overview, I think I'll conclude my remarks. I know you've all read the report, and it is available to members of the public, I believe, at the town hall and the library if they would like to review it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. White. Again, this, in typical fashion with committees, the document that was produced, again, is just a testament to the extraordinary efforts of this group. Jeff White chaired the group, the Cape Elizabeth School Space Study Committee included Joyce Freeman, Nancy Sanger, Ed Capano, Ann Chapman, Councillor Pearson, and school board member Charlie Greer. We're delighted at the document. It seems that no stone has been left unturned. There was even an addendum that came out prior to us getting the final copy as of October 1991. And we're very, very grateful for the tremendous amount of work and hours that went into this this project. At this point, I would refer it back to my colleagues for discussion. I would be delighted then to take a motion on this.
I have no discussion because I attended the other meeting, and I think they've done a tremendous job, and they really looked into everything that we had, as you might say, as far as the schools went. And again, I think they've done a tremendous job, and I want to thank them. You want a motion then?
We would appreciate a motion, Counselor.
Well, let me see what I can put together. It is recommended. Excuse me? I so move. But I'm recommending. It is recommended that you acknowledge the receipt of and the report and refer it to the school board for review and for a recommendation from the school board. And I'll put that in the form of a motion.
Second that motion.
Thank you very much. So that the motion will be acknowledging then receipt of this report, and we would be referring it to the school board for their more extensive review then and their own particular recommendations with respect to options that were presented in the report. We have a motion, a second, further discussion. Councilor Amaro.
I just can't resist a comment on how commonplace it's becoming to get reports from special committees that this council sets up that are just absolutely outstanding, that did require the enormous effort that went into this. And we really appreciate all of the citizens who did take the time and the thoughtfulness to come out with another excellent report. It's like about the 10th in a series of 10 outstanding reports that we've received from committees.
Ditto.
I thought it was a wonderful report, Mr. Chairman, and the only thing I have against the report is I couldn't get the chairman and the different members to come up with any money to do all the things they want to do.
It seems to me, Irv, that you chaired a committee that came up with some recommendations that had a big price tag attached to them as well.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. In the affirmative, thank you very much. Again, thank you, Chairman White.
One thing about it, Irv, you want to remember the old saying, once it goes around, it comes around.
Okay, speaking of tomes, we have item number 94 this evening. This is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding shoreland zoning and taking any necessary action this evening. I will first refer the item to our chairperson of the Ordinance Committee, Councillor Cogsell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I must say it's with great pleasure that I finally have some shoreland zoning ordinance amendments before me. As chairman of the Zoning Board of Appeals, over 10 years ago, we were trying to deal with the present ordinance. It was very confusing, very ambiguous, and a number of letters were exchanged between the Zoning Board, the Planning Board, and the Town Manager. Now, thanks to the state of Maine, we are required to update our zoning ordinance. And we also have to revise the official zoning map, which will depict this North Shoreland Zone. For those towns who do not upgrade their shoreland zoning, the state may impose a new shoreland zoning ordinance and bill the town for its legal expenses. State shoreland zoning involves more than just the shoreland zoning. The state is requiring sensitive natural areas such as wetlands and floodplains to be zoned resource protection. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council is about to enact, I hope, next month, this ordinance to be in compliance with the state law and also to help with the approval of our comprehensive plan. The shoreland overlay zone occurs in areas within 250 linear feet of tidal rivers, tidal waters, wetlands, and within 75 linear feet of streams. These amendments more specifically regulate how activities may be conducted in the shoreland zone, much as our present wetland ordinance restricts certain areas of town. For example, the current ordinance requires that erosion be controlled to the maximum extent possible. These new amendments include runoff control methods and mulching standards. The new standards also are more restrictive in that than the current shoreland ordinance. For example, there will be a minimum of a 75-foot setback from tidal waters for all residential structures. Those structures that do not meet the setback may be allowed to expand. Any expansion, however, cannot extend closer to the water or expand a non-conforming part of the structure by more than 30%. Foundations may be constructed for existing structures, although it's possible the structure may be moved further from the water's edge. The state is also requiring restrictions adjacent to wetlands, streams, along highly erodible slopes, and in the floodplain. The proposed amendments change the name of the existing critical wetland zone that we currently use to Resource Protection 1, Critical Wetland Zone. The wetland protection zone will be changed to Resource Protection 2, Wetland Protection Zone. To comply with state requirements, a Resource Protection 3, Floodplain Zone, will be created and will include areas within the 100-year floodplain which are not densely developed. There are no substantial changes to the wetland zone lines that are currently exist. Most of the changes in the wetland regulations, we have discovered with using the overlay map for our soils that we did discover 10 new areas that were not mapped from the previous map. Most of the changes to the wetland regulations involve technical amendments. For example, the names of wetland zones have been changed. A pond registration section has also been added to clarify which ponds can be registered and what are the benefits of pond registration. The timber harvesting section has also been revised to allow timber harvesting in wetland areas if a forest management and timber harvesting plan is prepared and submitted for town review. A change required by the shoreland zoning will place a mandatory 250-foot buffer around wetlands rated moderate or high value for wildlife by the Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife. We would like to plan a public hearing for December 9th. This amendment package is available for those who would like to review it at the library and at the town hall. Copies are available to be purchased. And you may contact the town planner, Maureen Amara, at 799-0115 for more information. The ordinance and various amendments have been reviewed by our town committee, a preliminary review by COG, and most of these suggestions have been incorporated. And as to the map, which we need to consider also in adoption of these shoreline zoning, in addition to the revisions in the shoreline zone, the revisions are intended to make the map more readable. The planning board has spent hours reviewing the present map, adding names of streets, cove, and streams that weren't previously there. Some of the newer subdivisions are now shown on the map. Wetland protection zone was once depicted with a solid line, and it became apparent that they were isolated pockets in the residentially zoned areas that should be combined. And there were several areas that we, as the ordinance committee, are recommending to you that they be changed. One is the Pleasant Avenue off Spurwink Avenue. There was a small pocket of RA zone land that we proposed to have rezoned as RC. The state has required that all hydric soils be zoned for wetland protection. Our current wetland ordinance divided these soils into two categories for zoning purposes, and we can continue that type of category with this map because we feel that it is more clearly adaptable to our town. And there is supposed to be some latitude where you can sort of adapt the recommendations from the state to suit your town more properly. The R1 zone, it has very poorly drained soils. The RP2, poorly drained soils. But we feel this is a very reasonable way, and we feel we have a good case to present to the state if they should question it. There is a smaller existing wetland area north of Sawyer Road that is not on the soils map, and immediately south of that area there's an area of very poorly drained soils which should probably be zoned RP1. An area north of Eastman Road that is currently zoned critical wetland may be more appropriately zoned wetland protection. The, of course, the wetland map is subject to field verification. And whether or not these have been actually verified, this is to use as a guide for the code enforcement officer and the planning board until things are verified in the field. I want to thank our planner, Maureen O'Mara, for so briefly condensing the full impact of this 32-page, not to be outdone by previous ordinance committee chair people, shoreland zoning ordinance. And she also has brought, as I believe, the map that's to be considered in the public hearing and adapted simultaneously with this own ordinance. We have to thank Ms. O'Mara also for her dedication to make things simpler for us to understand in the hours that she spent in coloring the black and white map.
She stayed within the lines very well.
It also makes it much easier to distinguish the various areas in town. Are there any questions from fellow councilors?
Well, Phyllis, I don't have a question. I want to thank you very much. I know the Ordinance Committee has worked very, very hard to bring this document to our council meeting tonight in hopes of bringing it to public hearing on December 9th. I remember watching the planning board. The issue was so overwhelming. They took the first 17 pages 1 month and then followed up the next month with the other half. And it is really a labor of a tremendous amount of work. And I'm delighted in the final product we have. And thank the Ordinance Committee. Council Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I work as a member of the Ordinance Committee, worked on this, and drives me up a wall. I get in the morning, whether it's raining or the sun comes out, whether I can, which way I can go. And I notice here, and just kind of brushing through it in the agenda here, and wondering maybe the question should go to the manager. The zoning map of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, shall be certified by attested signature of the town clerk and shall be drawn to a scale not less than 1 inch equal to 2,000 feet. Are we going to have to put this map together, and what's it going to cost us to have a map like that to, for your clerk to certify? Now, do you feel that one is that way?
I'm getting a nod from the town planner that that does meet the appropriate scale.
This, yeah, this meets the scale, and it's a new improved version of what you're currently using. And one of the new improvements is there's a line right underneath the title that says it's certified by the town clerk, and once it's adopted by the council, the clerk will be able to sign it and put her seal to it, which will either make it more official, where right now she just writes a statement on it saying it's the official map. But this would be the map that you would adopt.
So this is going to be a much better map than what we had before, which was used as a guideline. Is that correct?
This is still a guideline, but it's better in that it has a lot of the information that was missing off the previous map, and that it's called the zoning map, whereas the map you're using right now is called the proposed wetlands map. It's also better in that I believe it more clearly depicts where the wetland protection zone is, because it's depicted by a solid line rather than a collection of dots. It also depicts the shoreline zone as a collection of dots rather than just something someone has to kind of measure out 250 feet using their eye and figure out whether or not they're in that zone or not. But this still does have to be field verified.
Okay, that's what I wanted you to say, because I wanted the people to hear it.
And
that is still only a guideline, and it's got to be field verified.
And this map has an actual note on it now that says that all the lines are subject to field verification.
Good. That's all I had.
Other input this evening. I would ask for a motion. Please.
I just want to thank our planner, who has spent many, many hours and has been very diligent and helping to pull together such a complicated document. So therefore, I move that we set for public hearing on 7:30 December 9th at the Town Hall the proposed shoreline zoning amendments and the map.
Second motion.
There's a motion and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Ms. O'Meara. Item number 95 this evening, to consider a proposed amendment to the subdivision ordinance regarding construction inspection and taking any necessary action. I will defer to the town manager. Michael?
Yes. Currently, after a project is approved by the planning board, there's a requirement that we obtain a letter of credit and that the work that goes on is monitored not only by the town's engineer, but also by a construction monitor hired by the private party, by the developer. Under the current ordinance, it's required that construction monitor be from the same firm that designed the entire project. We've ran into a number of instances, one in particular recently, where the developer did not want to continue to employ the same consulting design firm that they'd used through the process. Thinking about this, and in retrospect, it was felt that perhaps that there ought to be a little more leeway, because particularly with some of that particular field, the engineering field and design field, in this economy, you don't get the same personnel anymore. Some of the firms, are even disappearing. And furthermore, there might be an opportunity to hire a monitor that we feel might be better qualified than a firm we really weren't too pleased with that went through the whole process. Another concern is that there's no, it's almost like guaranteed employment for these folks. If the developer is dissatisfied with the work of someone who's gone through the planning board process with them, there's no way they can get rid of them. Our ordinance requires them to continue to employ them. So what this ordinance provision would do is require that the construction monitor continue to be with the project's design engineer or landscape architect, or there could be an experienced construction monitor to be approved by the town manager and employed by the owner. There would still be record drawings based on field logs, and none of that would change. But primarily what this does, it gives a little bit more flexibility in who should be a construction monitor for projects. But nonetheless, any project monitor would need to be approved by the town. So the guarantees are still there. I would recommend that, the planning board has looked at this and recommends its adoption, and would suggest you set it for public hearing.
Thank you very much. Discussion on this change, this proposed amendment.
Mr. Chairman?
Counselor.
I move that we send this item to the ordinance committee.
Seconded.
There's a motion to send this to the ordinance committee, and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor? I'm sorry, did you put your hand up for further discussion?
Yes, I did. I just wanted to get the manager's reaction to the letter from our town engineer, Bob Hunter, as far as his two concerns.
I haven't reread it this evening, so I don't remember all the details on it. My recollection, when I first read it, was, you know, while I'm appreciative of the engineer's concern,
had more to do with any changes in the liability of design as one.
You know, it would
we
not
talk about this in our ordinance committee meeting anyway, did we?
No, we didn't.
No, I said we can.
You can.
We will.
You could, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, if I had said that it'd be set for public hearing, I misspoke it. I should have said to go to the ordinance committee. I think I did mention public hearing.
Well, the motion is to go to the ordinance.
The motion is.
It was a motion to go to ordinance, and that's where the motion is at. We didn't
we'll
vote yet.
Keep the manager straight.
That's right. Is that the answer, Councilor Cogswell, the fact that would be brought up in the ordinance committee, those two concerns by the town engineer?
Okay.
Any other particular concerns? There is a motion and a second. All those in favor? That does carry 7-0. Thank you very much. Item number 96 this evening is to consider the status of the fiscal year 1992 budget and taking any necessary action. I will again defer to the town manager.
When this particular item was placed on the budget, it was before the governor spoke last week as to potential budget cuts. You have before you a sheet that I referenced earlier this evening that really shows what we're looking at. I'm not going to repeat all the numbers since they were mentioned earlier, but I would like to return to the bottom line on the sheet, and that's essentially that what we're looking at is taking a budget over 2 years from an amount of reduction of about 17%, $675,000. I think it's really important that you have a sense of the magnitude of how much money that is. That is the cost for our entire police department. Added to that is the current cost of the entire fire department, the amount that we spend for all of our streetlights, the amount we spend to maintain and improve the town hall, to maintain 1226 Shore Road, to maintain the Spurwing Church, to maintain the public safety building, and to maintain the Engine 1 station. When I say maintain, I'm talking about heat, power, painting, everything else. You know, we are talking about a tremendous amount of money in, you know, what is essentially a relatively small budget. In this past year's budget, reduced almost, the great majority of any capital outlay. There were about $300,000 in cuts. We're looking at, you know, a second magnitude of cuts of about another $400,000 over the next year. While as difficult and painful as it was to have done the last time, it is nearly impossible to do a second time, because the areas that we cut, the council cut this past year, just aren't there to cut again. Something is going to have to give. I think, you know, we need a rethinking of a lot of issues. I really look forward to, you know, a cooperative process with the school department and with community services. I have every reason to anticipate that, you know, once they understand the seriousness of this problem, that, they'll be very agreeable to working with everyone to try to resolve this. Specifically, we have an immediate shortfall that we need to address of about $200,000. The exact amount is still unknown, depending on what the legislature does. I had put together a memo on November 6th, before the governor spoke, again, repeating myself, that recommended that we use $5,000 of the council contingency, that we recognize some savings we have found with the regional waste systems budget of $20,000, and that we eliminate the proposed Shore Road Shoulder Improvement Program, and saving $75,000 as a result from that. I made another list of cuts that said, you know, if the council didn't want to abandon Shore Road, other things you might want to look at. When I prepared this list, I had no idea that we would have to, you know, not only take everything on this list plus some more, but to give you an idea and give the public an idea of what we're looking at, if you like, I will briefly go through this list. We would reduce the staff in the town office, thus creating longer lines when people come in. Under this proposal, the town council, two members attending a conference in Washington, D.C. in the spring to learn and to fight against federal mandates would be eliminated. The entire council contingency would be used up. $5,000 that had been set aside for land acquisition fund contribution would be eliminated. $5,000 that for the implementation that you had set aside for all of your goals would be eliminated. We would try to consolidate public hearing ads of the different boards, thus saving $500. We can recognize the savings from our theft and dishonesty bond because we've been able to combine it with the risk pool program. $600 would be saved if we eliminated televising of the planning board. $500 if you didn't make a contribution to the art museum that was intended. $1,500 from a cut in cutting the Arts Commission fund in half again and cutting the Conservation Commission in half again. Both of these areas already took substantial cuts during the last budget process. In the administration area, reducing even expenses to attend local meetings and that type thing. All the national had already been cut out. In the assessor's office, eliminating the replacement of the secretary when she's out. In the planning budget, a number of cuts of everything from books and everything else of $800. Eliminating the municipal funding of the DARE program, relying solely on private contributions. That, as everyone is probably aware, is a program to encourage young people not to use drugs. Eliminating the BUSTER program, the K-9 program. We think we're able to work out something now, finally, been working on it for several months with the Animal Refuge League, the fee that they extorted earlier in the year, whereby we think we can get around that through working out an arrangement with an additional kennel that we have found in the town of, it's either in Falmouth or Cumberland. Early this year, a fire department deputy resigned. We did not replace him. We can save $1,200 there. Reducing street lighting, I put $1,000. My sense there was we could reduce street lighting along Route 77. I wasn't really looking at going into individual neighborhoods when this was suggested. Public Works does not have a personal computer. We would eliminate the